couple of weeks ago, we looked at a gun that was scrap value, not worth doing up. This gun is in similar condition. However, this one is worth a few thousand. This is a Stephen Grant. Today, we're going to have a little look over it. So before we really look over this gun and how beautiful it is, it's probably worth talking about why this gun is worth money. Well, it's difficult to say. I was about to say it's because of the name on it, but it's not. It's because of the quality of build associated with the name upon it. And that name is Stephen Grant and Sons, which is the next one to Stephen Grant. So we'll talk about that in a sec. Who was Stephen Grant? Let's go with who was Stephen Grant. He was born in Ireland. He was an Irishman. And he was born there in 1821. That's a long time ago. He was apprenticed to Kavanagh of Dublin before then moving to London, where he was, I believe, worked for Charles Lancaster, one of the great gunmakers. From Lancaster, he went to Boss on Lancaster's death. Interestingly, both of those were top London gunmakers, so he obviously was a great gunmaker of his own right. When Thomas Boss died, he went into business as a managing partner with Thomas Boss's widow, which was about 1857. After 1857, he stayed there for a full 10 years, working and building some of the best guns about. And then in 1866, he went off on his own, and you'll find some of his own guns from 1867 onwards. This was a funny period. Obviously, you've got a big change in gun making across that course of time, so you'll find some very early representations of his work that are not centerfire shotguns, which is quite cool. However, he continued to make great guns. From the start to finish, he'd always clearly been a good gun maker, and these sort of things continued throughout his trade. One interesting thing about Grant that, well, I can't show you today because it's a top lever gun, is that he was famed for making side lever guns. Side lever guns, obviously with a push down side lever on the side, are, I think, extremely elegant and beautiful. He did side lever hammer, side lever hammerless, did side lever trigger plate, he did all sorts. The theory being that he didn't want to pay the patent money to Scott and Purdy for their bits, their top lever and top lever spindle. And so long after they went out of fashion or were superseded with a top lever, he was making side lever guns. So if you would like a gun with all of this sort of later high quality of build and technology from like the late 1800s or even the early 1900s, you can get one with a side lever instead of a top lever, which is, well, remarkable. Either way, the side lever guns are beautiful. Whether for any reason he built them or did them, they are stunning and fetch a premium as Grant guns. However, Grant guns fetch a premium anyway because of the quality of build. Anyway, clearly he did good. He did a good job of building guns. He had some great contacts. He made guns for royalty here, domestically and abroad, for highborns, domestically and abroad. And was really one of the great London gunmakers. You know, he was competing with the likes of Boss and Purdy for quality, and nobody questioned it because they were that good. From the formation of his company to 1889, the guns were labeled Stephen Grant, and then in 1889 they became Stephen Grant and Sons, and then in 1898 Stephen Grant passed away. The quality of his guns continued to be great up until about 1925, and in 1925 it merged with Lang, and it became Grant and Lang. And then in 1960, it became Atkin Grant Lang. So in a way, Grant still survives today, which is mildly exciting. Who knows? Mild excitingness aside, Stephen Grant guns still command very good value because their quality of build was impeccable. They really were as good as you could get back then. And I expect if they were still around today, would be as much of a household name as Purdy or Hollands or Bosses in the gun trade. However, many people would look at these and not really know what it is, because it is just another old sidelock until you look closely and observe the quality. So we're going to do that now. Let us look at this beautiful machine, which is in utterly awful condition. Starting at the back, you have a thin horn heel plate. You can see just from the quality of the engraving on the screws that this is very nice. The wood very unexciting, but the lines and dimensions and specifications of it, even to the finish with 100-odd years of wear, is still stunning. Checkering on this would have been flat point, best flat point, as you can see. Somebody used this to the point of being utterly used. It'd be beautiful gouge out the side there. I love the oval being as high as it is on the stock. It's a real classic look. I think a lot of people put them very low nowadays, certainly in the over and under market, which is sad. This was once in a pair, but more than likely not an original one, just from the lack of twos elsewhere. Engraving across the lettering, across the trigger guard, however worn, is just so fine and superb. Drop points, very large drop points actually, or teardrops, whatever you want to call them. An interesting one, I was chatting to someone the other day, asked why they exist, and I couldn't answer them because I don't entirely know any practical reason why they exist. It is an art, is a show off of the art to show that it is an exceptionally made gun because they are hard to make look good. But they're a sign of quality and, I guess, fashion more than anything. Now, when it comes to the actual lock and actions, the locks on these are beautifully put together inside. And the engraving is exceptional. The carving around the fences here is a typical grant, but it is beautiful, don't you think? Just, this is metallic art, the way the beading works, the engraving up on these edges, up these bevels here. It's, I think, as good a side-by-side as one could ever find. I like it anyway, but of course I like it. It's a pretty gun. The forend on this particular gun, there isn't much left to be honest. Most of it's worn away. You can just about see some original checkering, the big lump missing there. But what you can tell is just the quality of this forend tip, the quality of the engraving. I keep saying quality and repeating quality. It's kind of hard to tell on camera if I've got an AOA number 2 and put it next to this, the difference between them. Until you look closely and you just go, this is perfect. It really is perfect. Nobody's rushed this engraving. Nobody's rushed it at all. It's nicely done and it stood the test of time. The metalwork has stood the test of time. You know, the wood has shrunk and been put next to lots of oil and heat and been rubbed off to the point there is nothing left, basically. But the metalwork really has stood the test of time. It is beautiful, I think, anyway. The barrels have been re-blacked at some point during their life and hide a few sins in terms of a little bit of pitting here and there. They ring true, they're nice, I like it. They're well put together, they pattern exceptionally, all grants do, but I think every gun from that era did have to. It's worn at the joint. It is £1,000 of work away from where it needs to be. Realistically, probably a little bit less. Depends, right? We did that thing on the to scrap or not to scrap, and I was like, no, there's no need, as long as it goes bang, you're fine. I don't know. You wouldn't want to restock it, that would be a shame, but maybe just to touch up the checkering. I think if you touch up the checker on the forend, you would go through to the metalwork. There's that little wood left on here. Either way, a little look and a little glimpse at one of the finest gun makers that ever walked the earth, or at least made guns. And there is a Stephen Grant. Hope you appreciate it as much as I do. Guys, take care. Thank you very much for watching. Have a great day.